morning. Happy Resurrection Sunday. You guys can come find a seat. Don't sit down, but you guys can find a seat. And we are going to begin our worship service with some worship. All right. Father God, we just come before you now, and we are just here to declare your glorious name, Lord. We lift up and praise the God who saves, Lord. We ask that you just speak to our hearts now, Lord, and let us worship you undividedly, Lord. In your name, amen.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. All your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes, walking in freedom, for God so loved, for God so loved the world. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, for the one.
Thank you.
live in a name. Morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. Where death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your Savior, suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
The saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God. We were awaiting without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle. Thank you.
other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus for our Savior died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, created one, God of glory, majesty, praise
that storm was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all would come to the Father our restore, and the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit did the flame. Now this gospel truth of shall not fade. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the
Yes, Lord, we glorify your name. We're thankful for your freedom that we have found in Christ, that we found through the cross, Lord. We thank you for your suffering, that you are willing to die for us, Lord. And we praise that you have conquered death. Lord, we love you, and in your name, amen.
He is risen.
Amen.
Awesome. Well, welcome. Welcome to Pine Valley Community Church 2023 Easter service. I want to take care of a couple of housekeeping things first. Number one, if you have a little, I'm talking a little, nursery. We have a nursery set up inside. Feel free to use that. Number two, I don't know, some of you may have noticed that there's some things different around here this year. And yes, I'm talking about the bathrooms right over here. So, right behind the shed. It's not behind the shed, but there are actually a couple of outhouses back there, and you can see Mr. Ed over there pointing everybody in the direction to go. So please, behind the woodshed, yes. If you can take a moment and do the connection card here, you can fill it out on here, put it in the offering, or if you want to use your phone, there's a QR code on there and you can fill out all the information. We want to know if you're here, and we appreciate you being here. There's a couple of things in the bulletin I'm going to go over real quick. We've got the Women's Mountain Moments coming up on April 22nd, 9 a.m., and this is going to be at Debbie Schultz's house, and she would like to invite all the women there. Sorry, men, it's not for you. But it's at, again, 9 a.m., April 22nd, and please RSVP Debbie, and her phone number is listed in there, and as well as her email address. The next thing is Growing God's Way. This looks like a lot of fun, too. Again, this is for the ladies. You're invited to join Babs. I know some of you know Babs, and she's going to be offering some tips, lessons on growing gardens, and you need an RSVP, and Mary's listed in here as the RSVP, and her phone number as well, and it will be $10, and it includes a spring gift and lunch. And then the last thing, we have their retirement picnic for Pastor Joe and Jenny. That's going to be April 30th after the second service. It's going to be there at the church. We're actually going to be using the connecting point, the new connecting point outside. It's a picnic potluck. We invite everybody to come and to be a part of the celebration for retirement. I know we're all going to miss them. So I want to encourage everybody to be there. If you have a pop-up, I'm sure it's going to be a beautiful day like this, and it'll be, we could probably use some more of those out there as well. Lastly, after the service is over, if you can pick up your children from the nursery before the Easter egg hunt, that would be appreciated, because there's no Easter eggs inside. And then lastly, any of the littles that are going to be performing here after we meet and greet everybody, if they can meet Miss Jessica right over here on the side. And that's all I have. There are some other things inside the bulletin if you want to take a moment to read through. But otherwise, if you want to get up, say hi to somebody. Maybe there's somebody you haven't seen in quite some time. And maybe meet somebody new. Thank you. Thank you.
talk a little bit louder. Give those kids one more hand. That was a great job. Way to go. Can we book you guys for next Easter?
Yes.
Yes, okay, they're on for next Easter. Amen. Who ordered the weather? Praise God. This is awesome. I don't think it was that long ago that this whole area was covered in, like, something white. Snow. Do you guys remember snow? Yeah. We loved it. We needed it. We need rain. Forecast is great today and the foreseeable future. Spring has sprung, as you can tell by all these lovely flowers right here, right? Totally real. But they look great. Everything looks great. Awesome. Awesome day. Thank you again, kids. My name's Jeff. I'm the associate pastor at Pine Valley Community Church, and we are going to get started with our sermon for Easter Sunday. So again, thank you all for being here. Super excited to share with you guys. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this amazing day, God. We thank you for just your grace and your mercy, Lord. We thank you for your presence in our lives. We thank you for your presence in our world, Lord. And God, as we read from your word this morning, I just pray that you would speak to each and every one of us. Open our eyes, our hearts, our ears, Lord, to what you would have to say to us today. We thank you for the celebration that is the resurrection of your son, Jesus, Lord, and all that that means so much, God. We praise you for that. We thank you that we're able to gather here as a church family in such beautiful weather, that we can enjoy each other's company, that we can fellowship afterwards. Just again, thank you so much for who you are, Lord. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I bought a shirt a few weeks back, and it's a shirt that I really love. It's got a particular slogan on it that in many ways I live my life by. And when people see the shirt, they immediately think I'm communicating this particular statement in a sarcastic manner. But in fact, it is the real deal. I truly think that this shirt can be a great conversation starter. I should have worn it today because I could have just gone like that and you guys could have all seen what it said. But I didn't do that. But there's a guy named Mike Rowe on a show called Dirty Jobs, and he sort of made this phrase famous. He says it often, and that phrase is safety third. Safety third. That is a statement that seems to be in direct opposition to the more well-known phrase, what?
Safety first.
Safety first is something that has been used for decades upon decades. It's a statement that's used that maybe if it's said by a business, it implies that our employees or our customers' safety is our number one priority. There is nothing higher than safety. Now, Mike Rowe is a very funny guy, but when he uses this phrase, safety third, he really isn't joking. He uses it as a conversation starter. In fact, he believes firmly that in many ways, a motto like safety first can actually be detrimental. And it's interesting because he's written a lot on this. He says that that motto can actually stall progress or success. Now, everything should be done so that you're not walking away. One thing we do when I teach the high schoolers, anytime I make a weird statement, they say, I'm going to go home and tell my parents that you said safety is not important. That's not what I'm saying, okay? Safety is important, and he says safety always. That should always be the case. We should always be doing things in a safe manner. But as far as safety being the number one priority, this is what he has written on this subject. He says, no company in the history of the world... He says, no company in the history of the world has ever put the business of safety ahead of the business of making a profit. And no employee has ever reported to work for the primary purpose of being safe. So businesses exist to make a profit. Employees work to earn a living. And all of that involves taking some risks. And so if safety were ever truly first, he says no risk would ever be permitted or encouraged. We wouldn't be allowed to take risk. No work would ever get done. No play would ever get done, for that matter. Things that we like to do that might involve risk, that are fun, that are enjoyable activities. And Mike Rowe tells some stories of how on his show there have often been safety managers from the company they were working with, and they were on the set. And he recalls a few times where that safety at all cost mindset was actually presented to him in a what he called a counterintuitive way. He tells a story of how on one of the episodes they had to be on scaffold. And the safety manager of the company came out and told them, everyone, this is company policy, you have to wear a harness when you're on a scaffold with our company. And that makes sense, right? But the scaffold that they were on was less than 2 feet high. So it would be like, you know, Mark Aragon comes up and says, hey, you're not allowed to be on my trailer without a harness. Because Mike Rowe receives the safety harness, and the strap for the harness was 4 feet long. And he said, why should I put this harness on with a 4 foot strap if I'm standing in scaffold that is less than 2 feet tall? And the guys replied, company policy, safety first. And that was it. He told another story of how they were working inside this building, and I don't remember exactly what they were doing, some kind of gross, dirty job, hence the name of the show. But they were in water that was like this high. And the safety manager came to everybody on the set and said, everybody that's in water needs a life jacket. And he goes, if I fall, I'm just going to get back up. Sorry, buddy, you have to wear this. Because why? Safety first. And so one of the reasons I really appreciate this discussion from Mike Rowe is that we are a people who like to be comfortable. We like to stay in our zone. We'll call that our comfort zone. We prefer not to go out on a limb. We prefer not to take risks. We often fear the consequences of making one tiny wrong decision. And sometimes that fear just cripples us. And so this morning we're going to read about a man in the Bible who took a risk. In fact, I'd say this man took a few risks, and we're going to read about the risk that this man took in Scripture. And you can turn this morning, or you can text whatever you're using for your Bible. You can turn to John chapter 3. John chapter 3. This man that we're going to talk about today was part of a group of religious teachers in Jesus' day who did not want Jesus out there teaching. They did not want him preaching. They did not want him healing. This man was a Pharisee, and he was a very high-level, important Pharisee. And this man took a risk. He took a risk to come and see Jesus and acknowledge, hey, you're doing some pretty amazing things, and I want to know what this is all about, because he says no one can do this kind of stuff that you're doing unless God is working through him. And so this man's name was Nicodemus. And we'll start from the beginning of John chapter 3, verse 1. It says, now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. So we read this first verse and we think, okay, this is a guy who is part of a group that is actively trying to just get rid of Jesus, a group that was not accepting his testimony, not accepting his teaching, a group that was in so many ways hungry for their own power. The things that they made the people do in the name of religion was really sick and disgusting, and they were authoritarian leaders, and they didn't like the way that Jesus was operating. But look at this. Verse 2 says, this man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs you do unless God is with him. Okay, so this is not what most people would have been expecting, for a Pharisee to acknowledge this kind of thing right to Jesus. A member of the most well-known anti-Jesus group is acknowledging that something's going on here, something supernatural. And so that's risky. I would say that Nicodemus is taking some sort of a risk. We know at the beginning of verse 2, there's something that indicates that he probably is taking a risk, because it says he came to Jesus by night. Maybe it was dangerous for him to go. Maybe he didn't want to be seen coming to Jesus at that particular time. Maybe he was just a night owl. I don't know. Maybe he didn't have a lot of free time and had to go after work when it was dark. But it says specifically there that he came at night. And he's acknowledging, Jesus has come from God. Something is going on with this man. Most people are considering him to have great power. Now, I don't know exactly what he means where he says you know, we know that you have come from God. I don't know if he's saying, you know, like the Pharisees, we see you do this work, and in front of the people, we shout you down, but then we kind of go into our own little break room, and we're like, dude, I don't know what to do with this guy. Like, what is going on? Like, this has got to be from God. I don't know if it's that type of conversation. I read that where he says, we know that you have come from God, the original language could really mean like there's a general sense from the majority of people that you're doing some pretty incredible things. So maybe it wasn't just like, hey, we Pharisees know that you're truly coming from God, but something supernatural is going on. And I would say something supernatural is going on in Nicodemus' heart because he's being drawn to Jesus. Verse 3, Jesus answered him, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Now Jesus talks to Nicodemus right off the bat about something that we might be familiar with, maybe a phrase that we've heard, and that's the phrase born again. And this is a spiritual rebirth, which we'll get more into that a little bit later. That's a spiritual rebirth, but Nicodemus seems to be taking Jesus literally here. He doesn't really fully understand what Jesus is trying to communicate to him. He asks the question, how can I be reborn? How can I enter my mother's womb again? Which I know makes a terrible mental picture. A full-grown man. Never mind. You get it, right? No, thank you. Verse 5. Jesus answers, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes. You hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. He just said a lot right there. Those verses, man, when Jesus says things like this, the way that he interacts and deals with people, I often picture like if there's a crowd listening to him and he's saying something super deep and really theological, people are just kind of sitting back and they do that thing that we do in church when like pastor says something really deep. We shake our head and we go, Everybody do that real quick. I usually look around and I think, what are they mmming about? I didn't understand what the guy just said up there. I don't get it. And so Nicodemus is in that situation where he just doesn't really get it. What does Jesus mean here? He says you must be born of water and the Spirit. And there's a lot of different interpretations on this as to what it might actually mean. Some people say, well, it simply means because he says that which is born of flesh is flesh, that which is born of spirit is spirit. So maybe he's just comparing physical birth with spiritual birth, like when we're born, sorry for all the womb talk today, but when we're born, we're in this physical sack of water and we come out of that. Maybe that's what it means to be born of water. I don't know that interpretation is the best one because it's like Nicodemus says, how do we be born again? And Jesus is like, well, the first thing you got to do is be born physically. And it's like, okay, check. Like I'm halfway to being born again. I've been born physically. But then there are other thoughts where some state that this could be a reference to like a water baptism, being born in water, and then the Spirit and after baptism being subsequently filled with the Holy Spirit. And I think that might be getting there, but not quite. I think that there are many other interpretations, and in terms of talking specifically about baptism, I don't see Jesus here saying, you know, be baptized and that particular act is going to save you. But when we think about what baptism represents, it represents cleansing. Okay, God cleanses us if we are his children. And so Jesus saying water and the Spirit, I believe that yes, he's saying you will not receive eternal life unless, if and only if, you have been cleansed by God and his Spirit lives inside you. Many scholars draw back to an Old Testament scripture and think that maybe Jesus is pointing out something that happened in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 36. You don't need to turn there, but I am going to read it. But as we go on with this story, it seems that Nicodemus maybe should have been grasping a little bit more. As a well-known teacher, a high-up teacher, he should be maybe familiar with some of the language that Jesus is saying. Because in Ezekiel 36, verse 25 through 27, God says this to his people: I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanness, and from all your idols I will cleanse you. And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh, and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and be careful to obey my rules. That is God making a promise to his people that he will work in their hearts. He will cleanse them with water. He will give them a new heart through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's a picture of salvation. That's a picture of what God wanted to do for his people. And that's a picture of what God can do for you. So therefore, Jesus saying water in the Spirit, I think it's a representation of that cleansing power that can only come from God. And Nicodemus still isn't fully going to get it. Verse 9, Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" And Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things?" It seems like even Jesus is surprised that he's not getting it yet. Come on, man. I'm alluding to Old Testament scriptures that you should be familiar with. Verse 11, "Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. If I had told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." That's when you go, yeah. Jesus has just said so much here. These statements are packed full of great doctrine, great biblical teaching, teaching that is absolutely life-changing when put into practice. He is saying to Nicodemus that he needs to understand these things accurately. And the only way to accurately understand these things is to have God's Spirit work in his heart and help him to understand. He says that so far, you and your Pharisee friends have not understood or accepted what I have taught. And verse 14 is another reference by Jesus to an Old Testament story, maybe even more specifically than the previous example we gave. But in verse 14, Jesus says, "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up." There's a situation with Israel in Numbers chapter 21 where their camp was invaded by snakes. Sound like fun? Yeah? I heard a yes right here. Their camp was invaded by snakes as a punishment from God. They were disobedient from God, and God sent poisonous snakes into their camp. And Moses, their leader, had a bronze serpent on a tall staff, and he held it high in the air. And the only way to be saved from those poisonous snakes was to look upon the bronze staff that Moses held up. And if you looked upon that, you would live. And Jesus references this situation. Again, Nicodemus should surely be familiar with this one. And he says that in the same way Moses held up the serpent and the people were saved, the Son of Man, Jesus, the Messiah, will also be lifted up. And with Jesus being lifted up and the people turning to him, giving their lives over to him, then they would not be saved from poisonous snakes, but they would be saved from so much more than that. In verse 15, Jesus tells Nicodemus what would result from following the Messiah. He says that whoever believes in him will have what? Eternal life. Whoever believes in him will have eternal life. Now, does that verse sound a bit familiar? Does that sound like another famous verse in Scripture? That sounds like the end of John 3:16. And as we're reading this, maybe you're thinking, man, you know what Jesus should do? He should tell Nicodemus John 3:16. Well, he does, because the next verse is John 3:16. But Jesus didn't think, oh, I should quote this scripture, because John 3:16 wasn't a scripture at that point. But that's something that we can use in our own lives. And he tells Nicodemus this, verse 16 and verse 17. We don't want to forget John 3, verse 17. He says to Nicodemus, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. That's it, right there. People call that verse the gospel in a nutshell. Everything you need to know about how to have eternal life. And Jesus originally spoke those words to this man, Nicodemus, a Pharisee, who was drawn to Jesus for some reason, who acknowledged that something was up, that Jesus must have come from God. And now Jesus just flat out tells it like it is. He tells him how to have eternal life. Now remember when we started out, we were talking about risk and about how it was risky for Nicodemus to come to Jesus. And there's the question of what ultimately happened to Nicodemus. And we don't really know, but there are a couple of other instances where he shows up on down the road in Scripture that seem to maybe indicate that maybe he did become a follower of Jesus. In John chapter 7, when the religious leaders are wanting to bring Jesus in to kill him, they're all talking about him, they're just kind of like, let's just bring him in, let's take him down, let's kill him. And Nicodemus stands up and basically says, why would we condemn a man without first hearing from him? In other words, let's stick to the process, let's stick to the law, let's hear his side of the story. And that's not Nicodemus standing up and quoting John 3:16 to all the Pharisees, but his fellow Pharisees question him like, what are you, one of his followers? What's the deal? What are you talking about, dude? And so again, in that instance, Nicodemus is taking a risk. And I think of all of our own lives, there might be steps that we take closer and closer to God. Maybe we take a risk here, or we take a risk there, or we acknowledge his existence, or maybe we even feel something spiritual at some point in our lives, and then it just goes away because we move on, or we get disconnected, or we go somewhere else, and maybe we're brought back to that regularly. And so I think this could just be a process of Nicodemus continuing to get closer to Jesus, God continuing to work on his heart. And then later, after they do crucify Jesus, spoiler alert, Jesus gets crucified. But an even bigger spoiler, he didn't stay dead. And that's why we're celebrating today. But when he was crucified, Nicodemus is actually one of the people who helped bury Jesus. So this is not at all something that he was required to do as a Pharisee. In fact, I've read some scholars think this could have been like Nicodemus took a deep breath and was like, I am burying Jesus because he's my Lord and I want to make this a public proclamation. Everybody's going to see me respecting him and burying him. It happened in John 19, verse 38 through 40. It says, after these things, after the crucifixion, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but he was secretly for the fear of the Jews. Again, another guy that took risks. Imagine if we had to take risks like that, where we couldn't be seen out here talking about Jesus. That's crazy to think of. But Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took away his body. Verse 39, Nicodemus also, who earlier had come to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen cloths and with spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. That's got to say something. There are no verses that say, and Nicodemus was a disciple of Jesus. And Nicodemus was a follower of Jesus. And there are few instances in the Bible where things like this happen, where we see someone who has some sort of spiritual interaction with Jesus, and then they seem to just maybe go on their way. Maybe sometimes they resurface in the story again, and we catch a little glimpse of their life, and maybe we can come to the conclusion that they became a true follower of Jesus. But when I think of these stories that are open-ended like this, I tend to think that it is intentional. God has allowed it so that we don't know what really happens to every single person in the Bible. And I think it's possible that we don't know all the details about a guy like Nicodemus because instead of thinking about him, maybe the story's not about him. Maybe the story's about what Jesus did, but maybe it also allows us to think about ourselves. What about you? Like I alluded to earlier, have you had casual interactions with Jesus? Do you talk often about the man upstairs, for example? Or do you occasionally find yourself saying, thank you, Lord, or thank you, God? Or maybe you say those things in anger in other ways. I don't know. But maybe you would admit, yeah, I've been touched by God at some points. There are times in my life where maybe I've felt close to God. But really, am I truly born again? I like to think that Nicodemus was a true follower of Jesus, and that maybe we can talk to him about his experience in heaven one day. The fact that this man that was a Pharisee was originally trying to stop Jesus, and then after his death, he went ahead and buried him, bringing spices, bringing aloes, bringing all this stuff just to show some respect to him. That's got to mean that something was continuing to happen in his heart. And then, of course, there is the rest of that story. Not about Nicodemus, but the story about Jesus Christ, who we are here celebrating today. He did not stay dead in that tomb that Nicodemus placed him in. He proved that he is who he said he is by raising from the dead, by conquering death itself. The kids performed this song here. Lord, I lift your name on high. That was a very popular worship song back in the day. Any like 80s and 90s children in the house? At one time, that was voted the greatest worship song of all time. There was a short time in my life where I played guitar, and that song is just like GCD over and over again, like all the 90s worship songs. It was just GCD. Like, you would start playing it, and it's like, wait, am I playing the sweater song by Weezer? Or am I playing Lord, I Lift Your Name on High? Because it was pretty much the same. Same chords. There's a little, I don't know, fact for you. But the kids performed this song, and it was a super popular worship song back in my day. And when you think about that song, it really does communicate so well what Jesus has done for us. You see, we live in a world that is not as it should be. Even if you have no belief in God or no relationship with Jesus or even no interest, you would have to admit that our world is pretty messed up. And the Bible, God's Word, gives us reason for that. And that reason is sin. It's humans. All of us have contributed to the downfall of this world because we have made the choice to live in ways that are the opposite of how God wants us to live. And that sin causes separation between us and God. Man is now separated from God because of sin. But the Bible also teaches that God has made a way for all of us humans to have a restored relationship with him. And I don't mean restored in the sense of, well, why can't things just go back to how they were 5 years ago or 10 years ago? No, it's restored to the way that God originally intended when he created the world. And the Bible says it was good. And that song kid sang puts it so well. You came from heaven to earth, singing to Jesus, you came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Jesus came down to earth to live the perfect life that we could never live. He didn't deserve to die. The Bible says that he died as our sacrifice. Romans 6:23 says that the wages of sin is death. Because of sin, death has entered into the world. And that is not just physical death, that is also spiritual death. Jesus talked about eternal life. There is the opposite of that if you don't have him. And so as the song says, Jesus came to the earth. He came to the cross, my debt to pay. He took our place. He paid our debt. And he rose again. Because Romans 6:23, though it says the wages of sin is death, that's not the whole verse. The second part of the verse says this: the wages of sin is death, but, and this is a big but, because it changes everything. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. That is definitely a reason to celebrate. Pretend like you're happy about it. Come on. There we go. We can be made right with God through his son, Jesus Christ, and only through his son, Jesus Christ. John 14:6, Jesus said this: I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And to go back to the scripture that we've already read, John 3:16, he said this to Nicodemus: for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. That is how to be born again. Not by going back into the womb, but by experiencing a spiritual birth, a rebirth that changes your life and that shapes your eternal future. So yes, we don't know for sure where Nicodemus is spending eternity, but we know that he was told about being born again and what all that means. And everyone here has been told what it means to be born again. And so let's take our attention off of Nicodemus and put it onto our own hearts. Are you born again? Do you have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ? Have you received the gift of eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord? Do you believe what God's word says about Jesus and that he wants to have that relationship with you? Maybe you feel like you had a relationship with God at one time in your life, but you've drifted away and it's just not important. And maybe there's time for a rededication of your life to Jesus. That could be the case. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we truly thank you for giving us such a glorious day, God. We thank you for this most glorious day that we can celebrate today, the most glorious day we can imagine, Resurrection Sunday, Lord. We praise you for who you are. We praise you for what you have done in our lives and what you have done in this world. We thank you, God, that we can come here and worship together, Lord. I pray, God, that if there is anyone here who does not know you or who has drifted from you in whatever way, Lord, I pray that you would grab hold of their heart and work supernaturally in mighty ways. I pray that they would turn to you, Lord. I pray that they would understand truly what it means to be born again, to be resurrected, what that physical representation of your son being risen, Lord, that is a picture of what you do to us, God, and we thank you and praise you so much. You make us clean. You've given us, Lord, new life. We ask, God, that the rest of our activities here would be continued with just an excitement and an energy that gives glory to you, God. We thank you and praise you so much. And that the rest of our day does the same. May our lives be lives of just singing praises and hallelujah to you, Lord. This day and every day is the day that the Lord has made. And let us rejoice and be glad in it. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
You guys can stand and sing this last song of worship. This is Nothing But the Blood.
The blood of Jesus. What can make me whole?
Almighty Father, Lord, we do thank you for today. We thank you for this church. We thank you for your word. We do thank you for what you have done through the blood of your Son, our Savior. Lord, we thank you that we can come here, worship your name, and claim that we are yours. We do belong to you. You have paid the price that we could not. Father God, we love you. We ask that you accept these tithes and offerings. We ask that you accept us and use us, Lord, that we could be your hands and feet here on the earth. Point us in the direction you want us to go and send us on your mission. Give us the words. Give us the deeds. Give us the strength to move forward. Give us the courage to act. Father God, be with us and help us move where we feel scared. Father God, as we go out this week, we ask that you protect us, that we keep us moving forward, that you protect us all during the activities today. I know there's a lot going on, a lot of fun that's going to be had. May it all be to the glory of your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.